Joined today by Jody Foster and Joanne Schell. And this weekend's event is sponsored by Igenix and is supported by our community partners. Like, we couldn't do what we do without the support of these partners year round. They support our activities and our mission. So thank you to our sponsor and to our community partners. As we said yesterday, one lucky registrant this weekend will be receiving a door prize of prevention products from Sawyer Products to keep you safe in the outdoors. And we will randomly select a winner at the end of this session today. And then we will announce that winner through email. Today, you're going to be really lucky to hear from retired Colonel Nicole Malachowski. Nicole will present with her story and followed by a Q&A session. Please enter all your questions for Nicole in the chat. And if you have any problems, you can text Jody at 720-280-2341. So enter all your questions in the chat, but if you have any issues, Jody will be taking texts as well. So with that, I would love to introduce our speaker today. Nicole is a 2019 National Women's Hall of Fame inductee, working for the, she is a USAF retired and has over 21 years of experience as an officer, leader, and fighter pilot in the United States Air Force. Upon her commission into the military, she was competitively selected to fly combat aircraft and embarked on an adventure among the first group of women to fly modern fighter aircraft. Nicole served as a mission-ready fighter pilot in three operational F-15E squadrons and accumulated over 23,000 flight hours, including 108 hours in combat. She has had the honor of commanding a fighter squadron, flying as a USAF Thunderbird pilot, serving as a White House fellow, and as an advisor to the First Lady of the United States. Nicole has forged a successful path through immense cultural changes in the military, as well as a significant adversity in her personal life. She's been happily married to her husband, Paul, an Air Force veteran for over 19 years. And when not hurriedly chasing her 10-year-old twins around, she finds immense meaning in practicing Tai Chi and so appreciated, also advocating for those impacted by tick-borne illness. I'm really happy to introduce Nicole today. She is very dear friend, and I know that you will get so much out of her talk today. So with that, I will turn it over to you, Nicole. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for the generous introduction, Monica. It is indeed a joy to be here. For those people that are tuning in, not only do I share the tick-borne illness story with all of you, whether you're patients, caregivers, or loved ones of somebody impacted, but I do share the state of Colorado. So this is actually my home state. And I definitely know that raising education and awareness of tick-borne illnesses within Colorado is so important. So kudos to the Colorado Tick-Borne Disease Awareness Association, Monica, her team, for doing that for my own home state. I really, really do appreciate that. I know yesterday there were some really like informational presentations from some serious icons in our community. I mean, when you think of Dr. Buriscano, Dr. Legner, we're going to hear again from Dr. Callahan when we post later tonight. I mean, that's just extraordinary stuff. I am not the scientist, nor am I a medical provider. I was just not smart enough to do that. But I was a fighter pilot who was grounded by a tick-borne illness. And in fact, I like to tell people, you know, I'm recruited to events like this by a tick. And like most of you, it was unexpected, unwelcome, and in many cases has been quite unpleasant. I am going to share my story with you today. I'm always a little bit nervous when I share my story with other patients and their caregivers, because I know that all of us walk this Lyme disease and tick-borne illness journey differently, right? It impacts all of us differently. All of us have different resources and support networks, and that can look different for different people. So I want you to know that I share my story just as one data point, knowing with great humility that there are many of you out there who are enduring the same, and in some cases, harder type journeys, okay? But I hope that you see, as I walk you through my story, that ultimately, it's a story of hope. And I want those of you out there right now that are dealing with the tick-borne illnesses and maybe at that low point in your life to walk with me on my journey today and watch, right, how I was able to get myself back to where you see me today, back to a quality of life of worth living. None of us asked to be bit. None of us asked to be sick. But here we are in a very supportive community with a lot of really good things going on. And when we're down and we're feeling bad and maybe we're not getting the support that we need, or, you know, medicine isn't able to help us and we're frustrated, feels a little bit like we're in the twilight zone. I want you to remember this. There is a lot to be hopeful for right now in 2021 for those of us in this community. I mean, first of all of the patient advocacy groups really over the last 1 to 2 years have been joining forces in a way that is just increasing the momentum, you know, kind of towards that tipping point we're all looking forward, you know, and Monica's group and organization is part of that. There's so many amazing patient advocacy groups out there, whether it's the local, state, or national level. We're seeing a real, like, I don't know, like synergy coming together that we haven't really had in the past. And that's a good thing. We're also seeing a lot of work on Capitol Hill. If you haven't been paying attention, there's some great lobbying going on. The Center for Lyme Action in particular has been leading our community towards having things like the Kay Hagan Tick Act passed, which was several tens of millions of dollars passed to increase, right, research at the federal level into Lyme disease and tick-borne illnesses. And that's a good thing. And I think the most exciting thing, and maybe I'm nerding out a little bit here, but man, look at the scientists out there that are just pumping out amazing, credible, peer-reviewed, you know, evidence-based literature that is supporting, right, our experience, the patient experience. You know, whether we're talking about someone as awesome as like Nikki Tall or Monica Embers or a John Alcott, there are serious brains, really smart people who are on our side, who are trying to get to the bottom of the science, because ultimately, and I believe this deeply, science will bridge the gap. It's science that's going to bridge the gap between your and my patient and caregiver experiences, right? And what we end up doing here in the medical field. And we all want to change that, right? We all want to see it get better. And there's great work being done. So there's three things to be hopeful for. And as I share my story today, my goal is simply to connect with you and validate your experience. I'm here to validate what you're going through, to say, I believe you, I care about you, and welcome to our community, because there is a lot of us out there that are willing to walk with you on this difficult journey. So with humility, I share my story today. One of the things people ask me, they go, man, Nicole, you got so sick. You know, I was bedridden, you were bedridden. How have you managed to find your way back to the way we see you today? Now, let's be clear, just because I look good and sound good doesn't mean, of course, that I'm 100%. To be honest with you, on my best days, I'm probably around 70% of my old self. And on my worst days, it could be back down below 50, you know, percent. But I will tell you this, I am way better than I was. And I have made great progress. And I have attained a quality of life that I'm proud to live. That's worth living. And I want you to know that there's hope like that out there for all of you. So here's my story. We're going to talk about flying. I'm going to use some aviation metaphors. You know, forgive me. I was a fighter pilot for 21 years. I love to talk airplanes and I love to talk about flying. When people ask me, how did you do it? I said, it's all really for me. Goes back to having a specific mindset. And it's what I like to call the harnessing headwinds mindset. Because it doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't matter what industry or profession you work in, what age you are, et cetera. The ground beneath every single person is constantly shifting. It's constantly changing. I mean, take the Lyme disease and tick-borne illness out of it. Let's just look at the last 18 months for the entire world. That's the one thing, right, that connects us, this idea of change. And I like to, you know, kind of relate that to headwinds as a pilot. You know, headwinds, when they come along, can sometimes be pleasant and nice and breezy. But let's be honest, usually when headwinds come along, they are unexpected, usually out of nowhere. They are unwelcome and they can be severely disruptive. Does that sound familiar to any of us? I mean, all it took was one little arachnid, right, to get each and every one of us. Can you believe that? And that's the headwind that we're all dealing with. But I am a firm believer, and I want you to hear this. I'm a firm believer that with the right mindset, we can actually harness those headwinds to our favor, to the favor of our recovery, to the favor of ourselves as individuals, and to the favor of the communities, right? The families, the organizations that you're a part of and that you want to get back to being fully a part of. So that's kind of the mindset I want to talk a little bit about today. But I want to start off by introducing you to somebody or something that's very special to me. If you look on the screen, that's the mighty F-15E Strike Eagle. That's the aircraft that I flew for the majority of my career. I was in 3 operational or forward combat fighter squadrons. I commanded a squadron of F-15Es and their amazing air crew that go with it. This jet right here carried me and my friends safely in and out of combat more times than I could count. She is a beast. And I like to remind people that yes, indeed, it is a she. Okay. Now, here's actually one of my favorite quotes. Some of you may have seen this quote before. It's kind of famous. And as you're reading that, I want to tell you a little bit about headwinds from a pilot's perspective. Okay. To me, as a fighter pilot, headwinds meant everything. They could dictate our route of flight, our altitude, our speed, the amount of fuel I have to carry. Headwinds can even dictate, right, the trajectory of my weapons in combat. And in aviation, when we want to wish somebody well, we say, I wish you blue skies and tailwinds, because arguably blue skies and tailwinds are the best kind of flying weather you could have. Wouldn't it be great if our lives were all blue skies and tailwinds? But we know that that's not true, right? One, we got bit by a tick that changed our lives. But two, right, that's just not how life is. Because headwinds come along. And oftentimes, they force us to change direction. They may cost us time. They may cost us fuel. And at their very worst, headwinds can actually take away options. But there's something I want to describe to you from a pilot's perspective that make headwinds so cool to me and so helpful. We will always, only 2 times, okay, I'm sorry, there's 2 times that we will always turn into and seek out headwinds, and that's for takeoff and landing. Interestingly, takeoff and landing are arguably the most risky phases of flight, but by turning the aircraft into the headwinds, we're able to harness them to make those very difficult transitions, like the one you and I go through with tick-borne illness, a little bit easier, safer, and smoother. And so it's with this harnessing headwinds mindset that I'm going to briefly share one story from my flying career, and then I'm going to share my tick-borne illness story with you so you can see what the harnessing headwinds mindset at least looked like in my life. And maybe you'll be able to apply that lens to the challenges that you're facing, not just in your tick-borne illness journey, but in your personal life and, of course, in your professional life, because what a year it has been, okay? But before I do that, I want to show a quick video. One, because when a fighter pilot comes to speak, there's always this expectation that we show a cool video, but there's also a point to the video I'm about to share, okay? I did, in fact, have the opportunity to fly a different jet, the F-16 painted red, white, and blue that you see on the screen in front of you. I had the privilege of flying with the United States Air Force Thunderbirds. Some of you have maybe been to an air show or seen them fly, but it's a pretty elite thing. I mean, there's 12,000 pilots in the active duty Air Force. 3,000 of them are fighter pilots, and of that, only six have an opportunity to ever fly as an Air Force Thunderbird pilot. Indeed, the privilege of a lifetime in a career. I point this out because I like to remind people, right, tick-borne illness can hit anybody, right? The most fit, mentally, emotionally, physically fit, courageous, successful people amongst us. And this is me, this video, at the height of my career. Little did I know, right, that this little eight-legged arachnid was going to come through, you know, and change my life. But when I show you this video, I wanted to set some context on how high performing I was and how much, right, that tick bite, you know, changed my life forever. But then I'm going to talk about how I was able to harness that headwind for takeoff again into what you actually see today, okay? But there's something else. Anytime we'd fly these air shows, right, the 6 jets go out and fly and people love it. It's a great feeling to go to an air show, right? You know, kind of a middle-class American thing to do. It's patriotic. It's feel good. Kids love it. It's a great family event, et cetera. And when we would fly, we would land and we would go to the autograph line. So right after we would land, I'd be all sweaty and tired and people would want to take pictures and get autographs, but they'd always like make comments or ask questions. And some of them would really surprise me. One of the ones that always surprised me was people would say, wow, Nicole, that's really impressive. Like you've been a fighter pilot your whole career. Now you're a Thunderbird pilot. That is like super elite, right? I mean, it's nearly impossible for anybody to reach kind of that level of skill. And frankly, it is statistically improbable, but clearly it's not impossible. But they would say to me, you must be different than the rest of us. Somehow the path in front of you must have just been smooth. You must somehow be naturally gifted in a way that we aren't. And I would laugh and just shake my head, because my path to the cockpit of that red, white, and blue F-16 you see in front of you was littered with twists and turns, bumps and bruises, mistakes, failures, and headwinds all along the way. And when I watch this video, it's a reminder to me that the path to success for any one person or organization or team is always nonlinear. The path to success is always nonlinear. And for today's audience, us as tick-borne illness folks, the path to recovery, right? The path to improved quality of life is also nonlinear. It's also a unique and distinct journey for each and every one of us to get back into the cockpit of that F-16. But I'm here as living proof that it can happen, okay? So this video was taken my very first year on the team in 2006. I flew as Thunderbird number 3 in the right wing position. That's me in the jet you see in front of you. You see the little number 3 down there. About 50% of the in-cockpit video you see is going to come from within my jet. So you can go full screen, turn up the volume, and I hope you enjoy. Y'all, I miss that flying so much. Thanks for letting the old fighter pilot, you know, wax nostalgic for a bit. But I hope that you enjoyed that too. And there's actually a little bit of a point here. People talk to me a lot now that I was medically retired from the military 3 years ago for chronic systemic tick-borne illness. That's what it says on my medical discharge paperwork. People often come up to me, they say, Nicole, you know, I'm so sorry, you know, you were medically retired because of a tick bite. You know, you must really miss flying. And it's interesting. I don't miss flying. I know that sounds weird. I miss being with people. I miss leading airmen. I miss serving my country. And I used to think when I was in the Air Force and healthy that my legacy, my contribution to society, whatever you want to call it, my meaning was to become a general officer and fly fighter aircraft, right? I would be the fighter pilot and someday I'd sit in my rocking chair and that was my thing, right? And it occurred to me, having gone through this tick-borne illness journey, this odyssey is probably a best way to describe it for people like you and I, is that I was never meant to just be a fighter pilot. Being a fighter pilot was a lucky thing for me because it gave me the characteristics, the skills, and the traits to survive my tick-borne illness, to reinvent myself to where I am today, and to use my voice, you know, in a lot of ways for the voiceless. I was never meant to just be a fighter pilot. I was more than that. And so are all of you, okay? Some of you may have lost careers. You may be on pausing from careers. You may have to completely shift careers due to what this illness has done with you. I'm here to show you and prove to you that we all indeed have the power to reinvent ourselves at any given time, okay? and that there is hope after this illness. It was never meant for me just to be a fighter pilot. I'm more than that. I'm bigger than that. And my contribution is more than that. And so is the same, I believe, for all of you. So I think about this harnessing headwinds mindset, and I'm like, wow, I always fall back on aviation stories. And there's one I'd like to share with you. And it's all about learning to fly in turbulence. If you look on the screen in front of you, those are four jets in the diamond formation. I'm on the very top of the screen to the right wing, if you will, of the lead aircraft. And this is me during training season. We trained at a base called Nellis Air Force Base in Las Vegas, Nevada, which generally has pretty good weather. Look at those blue skies and tailwinds there, right? Wouldn't it be great if life was all blue skies and tailwinds? We had a 4-month-long training syllabus. We'd fly twice a day, sometimes on Saturdays. And let's go back a little bit. I started flying when I was 12 years old. And before I became a Thunderbird pilot, remember, I had been a frontline fighter pilot for about 10 years. I had flown in a lot of different types of weather, a lot of different types of environment. But I remember distinctly the first time I was flying as a Thunderbird during training season, and we encountered turbulence. And you'd have been like, Nicole, you just told me you've been flying since you were 12. Clearly you've flown in turbulence before. And I'm like, look, my friends, when you encounter turbulence flying at 500 feet, 400 miles an hour, upside down, 3 feet away from other aircraft, I can assure you that is a whole eye-opening type of experience. And this idea of turbulence, turbulence being change, turbulence being adversity, turbulence being those headwinds that you and I have experienced because of tick-borne illness, because of this COVID pandemic, the type of change and adversity that has come along in our personal lives, in our professional lives, we all endure turbulence. So I'm in the, towards the end, I guess, of this 4-month-long training program. And we're cruising along in my favorite formation, the diamond formation. So far, I'm doing pretty good in training. I mean, you do maneuvers a couple times, you practice them, the light bulb comes on, it clicks, you go on to the next maneuver. So I was feeling pretty good about how my learning was going along this syllabus. We go out and fly one day, and I'm just like chilling, it's blue skies, Las Vegas, life is good. And all of a sudden, boom, we hit turbulence. And as I mentioned, it's very eye-opening the first time that happens, whack, when you're doing it 3 feet away from these other aircraft. And the second I hit the turbulence, my natural instinct was to grip the stick really hard and to start fighting each and every bump of turbulence along the way, to fight to stay in position, to try to control the uncontrollable. Because here's something that's really interesting about turbulence. We know when the atmosphere is ripe for turbulence, like there's like fancy weather people that can predict, yeah, there might be some turbulence somewhere out here, but we can never predict exactly where turbulence will happen, how strong that turbulence will be, or how long that turbulence will last. Does that sound familiar, right? To the change in adversity that we all go through. And I remember hitting that turbulence, ba-bomb, and trying to fight the uncontrollable. I can't control the turbulence. The problem when you do that in an aircraft is that each time you make a counteraction, the next one has to be bigger and bigger and bigger until you get into something called a PIO, known as a pilot-induced oscillation. And I will tell you something, it's terribly inefficient. It makes for an extremely ugly air show. And at the end of the day, it was downright dangerous in what I was doing. But isn't that our instinct as human beings? When change and adversity comes along, we start to fight it. We want to try to control that uncontrollable. And in fact, when we do that, we can make things worse for ourselves because it's actually a very inefficient use of our limited health, time, talent, and treasure. So I'm out there flying in this turbulence, fighting, like I said. We land that day and we go into the debrief because we would always debrief the formation. That's where the learning came from. And the number 4 pilot, his name was Steve Horton. He's the one that's on the far right of the screen. He essentially flies underneath me. He was my instructor because he was a second year guy. He was experienced, right? He looks at me, he's like, dang, Nicole, you are a mess out there today. It was impossible for me to fly underneath you. Why were you moving all over the place? I said, dude, didn't you feel that turbulence? It was horrible. And I will never forget that moment. He kind of leaned back, exhaled, and kind of laughed at me, chuckled like in my face. And he's a dear friend of mine to this day. He said, oh, Nicole, we forgot to tell you the secret. And I'm looking at him like, what are you talking about? He says, we forgot to tell you the secret about how to stay in formation when we encounter turbulence. Would you like to know the secret? Yeah, bro, I'd love to know the secret, you know, information I probably could have used yesterday. He says, this is the secret. We promise each other as a team, as a formation, as a community, you and I, that when any single one of us encounters turbulence in our own jet, no matter what position we're in, no matter what formation we're flying, no matter what maneuver we're about to execute, we promise each other that if we feel turbulence in our own jet, we will immediately loosen our grip. Loosen your grip. The exact opposite of my instincts as a pilot, and dare I say the exact opposite of our instincts when the unexpected, like a tick bite, comes along and disrupts our lives. And I thought to myself, this guy is nuts. Why am I going to loosen my stick flying through turbulence 3 feet away from other jets? But I thought, okay, well, he's more experienced than me, so I'm going to take this advice. So the next day we go out, blue skies and tailwinds kind of day, but the atmosphere was ripe for turbulence again. And as we're cruising along, boom, boom, we hit that turbulence again. And I started to want to fight that turbulence. But I thought to myself, no, Steve Horton's the experienced guy. You know, he's like the Yoda of the team. He said to loosen your grip. And so as I'm flying, I thought, loosen your grip, right? That's what Steve said. And I did. I let go with 1, 2, 3 fingers, and I flew the jet just like this. And guess what happened? I was able to stay in position. Our formation stayed together, and we eventually exited this turbulence. And the beauty of it all is, like, the audience on the ground, like, they never even knew. But the thing about turbulence is that it doesn't last forever. And if we loosen our grips and we keep our arms around each other and we keep moving forward, our formation stays together as a community. And we will eventually, right, exit this turbulence together. So the next time you find yourself fighting the things that are out of your control, you didn't ask to be bit by a tick. You didn't ask to get sick, right, from a tick bite. You didn't ask to enter into mainstream medicine that really has a long way to go on their education and awareness on how to take care of people like you and I. You didn't ask for any of that turbulence. You also can't control any of it, all right? So all you can do is take care of yourself, your own healing journey, utilize the resources of this community, and let's all loosen our grip together, okay? So loosen your grip is something I tell myself when I find myself fighting those things very inefficiently, because you can't control it, okay? It keeps me forward-looking and it keeps me very positive. So to that end, I'd like to share my tick-borne illness story with you. That's the mindset, right, that I brought into this unexpected journey. I love this picture. That's my awesome husband, Paul. We've been married 20 years. He has been by my side through this entire tick-borne illness journey. From the time I got bit, he became my caregiver overnight. He essentially became a single dad to then 5-year-old twins, my daughter, Nora, my son, Garrick, who are now very happy and healthy fifth graders about to turn 11 next month. But it's important to remember, right? This tick-borne illness journey doesn't just impact the person who is bit. It impacts our caregivers, our loved ones, our households, our finances. You know this, and I know this. I was very blessed on my journey and continue to be blessed to be married to my husband, Paul, and to have children who understand my illness, what I need to do to manage that, and who help me maintain the positive quality of life I have. So where did the journey start? It's been 9 years for me. I know there are people who have been sick less, and there are so many people around the world who have been sick with tick-borne illness for decades. My story starts in the summer of 2012. I was the commander of an F-15E fighter squadron. That might not mean much to you, but that is the highlight of a fighter pilot's career. I was physically fit, mentally fit, spiritually fit. I was a lieutenant colonel, right? I was a graduated Thunderbird pilot commanding this amazing group of about 100 totally type A, professional, skillful, elite, macho men. It was good to be the queen. And I loved my life, right? It was the highlight of my career. And in the summer of 2012, commanding this squadron at Seymour Johnson Air Force Base in Goldsboro, North Carolina, because geography is important to people in our community, I came down with what felt like the flu. I now know there's no such thing as the summer flu, but at the time I was completely unaware of ticks, the pathogens they carried, what symptoms to look for, completely uneducated and unaware. So I basically took myself off the flying schedule. After about a week, I still felt like I had the flu. And at that point, I had developed a small rash on my right hip. So I decided, okay, Nicole, it's time to actually go see the doctor. Fighter pilots don't like to do that because we don't like to be grounded from flying, but I felt really bad. I had fever and malaise, joint pain, muscle pain, and this rash. So I went to my military flight surgeon on base and I said, hey, I haven't been feeling well for about a week or two. Oh, by the way, there's this rash on my hip. The rash, which I now know is an EM rash, had grown to about that size and looked like a perfect bullseye. I didn't know what that meant. And sadly, neither did my primary care physician. It was interesting at that time, I will distinctly remember this. He was so concerned about my symptoms and that rash, but he didn't know what it meant, that he brought in another doctor, a reserve doctor who was only in for the weekend, who happened to be a mainstream medical civilian provider during his non-reserve times, right? Kind of up north in Raleigh. And he was a much older, more experienced physician. And he looked at it and it was determined that it was a spider bite. So I was given some topical ointment and 5 days of antibiotics and sent on my way. You and I now know that that was probably not the right decision. Whether that was Lyme disease at that moment or STARI, Southern Tick Associated Rash Illness, you and I will never know. But we do know I was bit by a vector and we do know I got a bullseye rash that went away with central clearing. Okay, I sound so educated now. If only I was educated at that time. So unfortunately, over the next 3 months, my symptoms would get much, much worse. I would start to have droopy eyelid. I would have pins and needles, a lot of numbness along my face, down the right side of my body. I started to struggle to read and write. I started to have word finding problems and stuttering. I was having short-term memory problems, like walking into different rooms. And it's not the kind of stuff where you're like, oh, I misplaced my keys. You know what I'm talking about. It's excessive all day long, short-term memory, long-term memory. Clearly, right, I was not in a position to be flying a $65 million jet. Very hard for the ego of a fighter pilot to be grounded, and even harder for the commander of an elite fighter squadron to come off of the flying schedule. But once I started dropping things with my right hand and tripping over and dragging my right leg, I knew it was time, of course, to take this seriously. To the Air Force's credit, they sent me to some amazing civilian doctors who were up in Raleigh, North Carolina, with lots of testing, some which were invasive, very scary time. They found nonspecific, we've heard that term, right? Nonspecific white matter lesions on my brain. And so it became this, we think you're getting MS. We think you're going down the path of multiple sclerosis. All of your symptoms match this, but you don't meet the clinical definition yet. So we're going to track you. We're going to give you brain MRIs every 6 months until we figure out what's going on. Hopefully, Nicole, your symptoms will go away overnight as quickly as they came on. Yeah, that would have been nice. Unfortunately, I think you know how this story goes. During those 3 months where I started having those massive neurological issues, because we now know I'm probably going from early disseminated into late disseminated tick-borne illness, I was moved up to be stationed in Newport, Rhode Island. Yes, home of the ticks. And nowhere along here did the military ever give any kind of education or awareness on what to look for, which is really disturbing to me and something I'm trying to fix with the Department of Defense today. But about 10 months after my rash in North Carolina, I'm up in Rhode Island camping and hiking with my kids. And what do you know, 3 days later, my husband, I get out of the shower. My husband's like, what's that on the back of your leg? So we pull off a 3 to 4 day, I know this now, engorged Ixodes scapularis female tick in the summer of that year, 2013. So lightning struck twice. I had two bites, most likely reasonable to assume two tick bites within 10 months of each other. I went to the doctor with my tick and I said, hey, military doctor, what do I do? And she said, watch for a rash. If you don't get a rash in the next 30 days, then you're fine. We know what a horrible piece of advice that was. And there's no science to back that up. 50% of people who get Lyme disease never see a rash. And those who do, the rash may not even look like a bullseye. So bad advice, another opportunity for them to save this. Unfortunately, after that second bite, things got really worse. I added on a lot of night sweats. Sound like Babesia to any of my friends? Sure. They automatically assumed that I was going into menopause and sent me to an endocrinologist. So now I'm seeing neurologists up in Boston in order to track my probable MS. And now I'm going to endocrinologists for my sweating and my constant fevers. A fever of 100 to 101 degrees every single day. Not once did anyone ask about ticks or test me for tick-borne illness. A few months into this, I am struggling. I am struggling to read and write. Things have gotten much worse. My symptoms continue to wax and wane in very weird ways that were hard for me to track as a patient, hard for me to communicate in an organized fashion to my doctor, and certainly difficult, and I empathize, for doctors to fully get their arms around and understand. 3 months into it, that second bite, I went to a dermatologist to get a mole removed, totally unrelated. And I was feeling horrible. I could barely get out of bed, right? I knew something was wrong. And I just assumed it was me getting closer to my multiple sclerosis diagnosis. That's what everyone assumed. And that's what the doctors were telling me. That's all the testing that we've been doing. So she says to me, "How are you doing?" And it was the first time in this whole process, which is now just over a year long, that someone asked me that. And I immediately broke down and started crying right in front of her. All right. And she said, "What's wrong?" And I told her the whole story, and she sat and she listened for about 45 minutes and didn't interrupt me. Miracle of miracles. And I had told her about, and she says, "Have you ever been tested for tick-borne illness?" And I said, "No." She goes, "Would you be okay if I test you for Lyme disease?" And I said, "Sure, whatever." As you can imagine, the test for Lyme disease, Borrelia burgdorferi, came back 2-tier CDC positive, which should only be used, right, for clinical help, not for diagnostics. But at the time, those doctors used it as a diagnosis, and I was given 28 days of oral doxycycline. That's pretty freaking amazing, right? Because as you know, right now, 14 to 21 days seems to be the going thing from the IDSA and CDC. I got 28 days of doxycycline. And all it did was make me really, really sick. Think about it. Did I get Lyme a year and 5 months ago in North Carolina, or did I get it 3 to 6 months ago with this engorged tick? I can never prove which tick when ever gave me anything. But that 28 days of doxycycline made me so sick. I started having tons of cognitive problems, right? Sensory problems, sound sensitivity, sunlight sensitivity. The pain in my muscles and my joints was so bad. I fought so hard to hold on to my career. The doctors kept saying, "It's MS, it's MS. You just aren't there yet. We can't clinically diagnose you yet, but it's coming. Get prepared." So symptoms wax and wane, wax and wane, wax and wane. 4 years later, August of 2016, I'm working as the military aide to Michelle Obama in the White House. Career is going good, fighting my illness. I wake up in my house in Northern Virginia and I'm locked in. Yeah. I can't move and I can't speak. It was terrifying, terrifying. I had to wait for my husband to find me. I had these moments of temporary paralysis that would come and go that no doctor could explain. To their credit, they sent me up to Boston. I saw some amazing doctors at the Dean Center for Tick-Borne Illness who were able to finally crack the code, looking at my medical records, knowing I had 2 back-to-back vector bites, and they tested me for all tick-borne illnesses. That's right. My awesome, amazing career was gone in the blink of a bite. In the blink of a bite, an 8-legged arachnid broke this high-performing fighter pilot down to this. By that point, I was in a wheelchair. My husband was speaking for me. The military didn't know what to do. I couldn't read, write, walk, talk, any of that for the next 9 months. From the time of my first rash in North Carolina to my accurate diagnosis and start of treatment was 1,525 days of unnecessary suffering, more than 24 doctors from across 8 specialties, and 3 misdiagnoses along the way. I had a PICC line put into my arm up in Boston. I did several months of IV ceftriaxone, followed by about another year of different successive antibiotics and antiparasitics to treat the 4 different pathogens that those tests actually found in me. During that time, I said, "Air Force, what are you going to do with me?" They said, "We don't know. We're going to have to kick you out." I said, "Wait, the doctors figured it out. The smart people in Boston, give me the pill or the shot. I'm ready to get back in this jet and keep flying." And I'll never forget when the doctor looked at me and said, "I'm sorry, Nicole, you've been sick far too long. The infection has gotten to your brainstem, which is why you're having these moments of temporary paralysis. You're going to be in treatment and recovery for at least 2 years, at least, and you will never recover probably to 100% of who you used to be because you were too far gone, undiagnosed and misdiagnosed." Those were hard words to hear. For the next 9 months, I laid in bed 22 plus hours a day. My husband was my caregiver. We had an outside healthcare nurse come in. I could not interact with my children in any meaningful way, which was very hurtful as a mother. I spent the next year in rehab, the most difficult being vestibular rehab because I had a major vertigo and balance deficit. And in that time, the Air Force medically retired me. 21 years of honorable service, great career, no ceremony. They even mailed some of my retirement paperwork in a manila envelope to my house. Thank you for your service. And I remember laying in bed that day of my retirement, the 29th of December, 2017, feeling sorry for myself. Who am I if I can't wear my nation's uniform? Who am I if I can't contribute by flying fighter jets? I lost my career, my profession, my identity, my means for providing for my family overnight. What do I do? No one's going to hire you, Nicole. You can't read, write, speak, or talk. You can't work full-time, blah, blah, all this negative, negative emotion. And as I sat there in my pity party for about 3 days, which I think is reasonable and human, I finally said, enough, Nicole. You're a fighter pilot, dang it. Look at all you've gone through. You've been shot at in combat. You can handle this. And these words actually came to my head as I laid on the couch in pain. Yield to overcome. Yield to overcome. In that moment, I realized I wasn't asking myself the right questions. What do you have right now at your disposal to move forward? What resources can you go get right now to move forward? What do you need to do to put your health and recovery first above all else, right? Yield to overcome isn't about surrendering, quitting, or giving up. It's the exact opposite. It's about being present, taking ownership of what you're doing, being forward-looking, turning into that headwind for the takeoff to your next journey, to your next target, and to the next adventures that really do await you. Yield to overcome. And so in there, I was medically retired. All of those things happened, but I had a much more positive attitude. People say, Nicole, ooh, you're so resilient. And I love this term resilient. You and I, we need to be resilient. Those day-to-day battles, right? Maybe you have a Herx reaction. Maybe you lose a friend, right? Because they can't hang with your chronic illness anymore. Maybe you've lost your job. These things are freaking hard, right? But at the end of the day, we're more than resilient, you and me. We need to be. Remember, resilience is about like having yourself falling down, mistake, failure, hardship, and bouncing back to your old self. Living the tick-borne illness journey changes you. It is a crucible experience that fundamentally changes and shapes who you are as an individual. You can't just be resilient. You know why? Your old self doesn't exist anymore. My old self ceased to exist. I went through a crucible experience, as are many of you, and I came out better. Better as a human being, stronger for it, right? More human on the whole level, shaped in a completely different way. There's no bouncing back to my old self. She doesn't exist anymore. I am resurgent. You are able to be resurgent. You are able to take this headwind of tick-borne illness and turn it into something that makes you a more complete human being. We all have the power to reinvent ourselves at any given time. So the rantings and the ravings of an old washed-up fighter pilot, a harried mother of twins, and a survivor of late-stage neurological tick-borne illness. I stand in front of you as someone who struggles to read and write still. I have major autonomic nervous system dysfunctions, and I still have a significant balance deficit. But I also have a quality of life worth living. These unexpected headwinds, this dang tick bite, these tick-borne illnesses, a medical community that's still trying to figure out what to do with this is a headwind. Harness it. Don't forget to loosen your grip. Don't waste your limited time, talent, and treasure on things you aren't going to be able to change today. Use that limited time, talent, and treasure on your recovery and your health every single day. Let this illness make you a better human being. My level of compassion for other people is through the roof. I used to think I was pretty nice. I like to think I was, but I look at humanity like COVID long haulers with deep empathy, right? I am stronger, and so are you, than I ever gave myself credit for. And don't forget, it's okay to yield to overcome. Accept what is happening to you. Ask the right questions so that you can be forward-looking and resurgent in all that you do. We're going to have time for Q&A, all right? But if you don't get your question or you want to talk to me later, I'm on social media. I want to talk about this picture here. The jet on the left is my husband flying. The jet on the right is me. This was his very last flight before he retired, and our Air Force leadership was kind enough to let us fly together. I was his wingman. And this wingman concept, someone who always have your back, someone who always checks your six, is so important in the Air Force, but it's also so important in our tick-borne illness community. There are so many people who are willing to be your wingman. I'm one of them, right? Colorado Tick-Borne Disease Awareness Association, Monica and her team are out there. You are not alone. I believe you, and I believe you are going to continue your recovery and come out in a stronger and better place. There is hope. There is a lot of good things going on in our space. So in essence, I do wish you blue skies and tailwinds, but I also hope that you harness those headwinds along the way. So those are the rantings and the ravings of an old washed up fighter pilot, a harried mother of twins, and someone who's walked the same journey as you. So with that, I'll turn it back to my friend, Joanne.
Thank you so much, Nicole. Monica. Yeah, I just, you know, I've had the pleasure of hearing you speak numerous times in numerous places, and you always have a way of touching me at such a deep place. And so for that, I am so appreciative and such a gift to our group. So
the feeling is mutual, Monica. So thank you for what you and your organization do. And I want to thank everybody before we ask questions for giving me your time. Every time I share my story, it's cathartic for me because my recovery journey, like yours, is ongoing. So thank you for your guys' heart and your time today.
Absolutely.
So, okay, so far, so far we don't have any questions. I haven't seen anything.
I stunned you into silence.
Yeah, that's why I did. I went, okay, is anything going to come through? That's why I was waiting a second. I went, okay, are we getting anything? But nothing. Mm-hmm.
So people are stunned and shocked.
Sure, they're processing.
No, it is a lot to process. And Joanne, I know you had a question that you had wanted to ask earlier.
I did, in relationship to, you know, I was asking about, you know, did any of your children have symptoms? Do they show anything at this point in time?
Sure. Yeah, I think this is a great question and such an important topic for us to be bringing up and to be talking about. I mean, the medical literature clearly shows that Lyme disease, right, can be transmitted from mother to unborn child. This is not up for debate. The science is there. And oh, by the way, the CDC has even acknowledged it and most recently changed their website to reflect that. Up at the federal level, they've also put out different calls for information to study this very phenomenon more in depth. So the great news is science is coming, you know, to describe this and to hopefully help us come up with better diagnostics and treatments for pregnant mothers, unborn babies, et cetera. To your specific question, my children are about to turn 11. They are happy and healthy. They have no symptoms of tick-borne illness, which I'm very happy about. They are developmentally on their timeline, socially on their timeline, et cetera. I bring that up though, because they were born 3 months early. I went into extreme premature labor. And to this day, the doctors cannot describe why. Keep in mind, they were born in 2010, which was 2 years before my North Carolina bullseye rash. The question really here becomes, you know, how many of us people in this world, like let's just the whole state of Colorado, right? If we tested them, would test positive for tick-borne illnesses and be asymptomatic? We know that that obviously happens. Why do some of us become asymptomatic? Did I have tick-borne illnesses living in me that were doing fine and remission before I got the bullseye rash and that next bite? So is it possible that I transmitted some stuff to my children in utero? Yeah. Do I see any symptoms in them? No. For me and my family, and I judge not, I will not test my kids for tick-borne illnesses unless I start to see the symptoms. I'm grateful for being trained and smart on what to watch and what to look for. And I'm even more grateful that I have this community as my wingmen who would be in a place to help my children through that. So that's my most thorough answer, Joanne. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we did have one question come in from Kenny. He wants to know what type of Lyme disease therapies worked for you.
Yeah. So, you know, thank you, Kenny, for the question. And I think it's so interesting. First of all, I am not a medical doctor. I am not giving medical advice, but I'm happy to kind of give you my ideas as a patient. What I've learned sitting on some of these federal panels, like the Department of Health and Human Services Tick-Borne Disease Working Group, which I have sat on. I have did 4 years in a row reading grants for the Congressionally Directed Medical Research Program on tick-borne diseases. So I've learned a lot as a patient. I'm not a doctor or a scientist, but I have gotten a little bit smart on this stuff. Each person is unique, Kenny, right? Some people prefer not to go the antibiotic route. Some people are so sick, they can't even handle, right, antibiotics. The beauty of that is that there are herbal type treatments out there. And I think doing the research, comparing the pros and cons to those two, are going to be tailored to you as an individual with your choice, right? What can you afford, which is a crazy thing to ask, right? What resources do you have? Who is supporting you through this? How much time do you have, et cetera? For me, as severe as I was with an active infection on my brainstem, which we have scans of, I needed immediate high dose intravenous antibiotics. And I remember when the doctor said to me, here's everything. And I'm like, great, give me a shot or a pill. I'm going to go back to flying jets. She looked at me and she's like, you know, that's not going to happen. She says, but I'm not letting you leave Boston without a PICC line in your arm because this could kill you. And I will never forget how crazy that was. So my need for antibiotics in that instant and in that moment, I think was very real and was the right answer for me. Depending on where you are on the symptoms and the suffering level and where your quality of life is, it's a brilliant conversation to have, right, with your doctors. It's all about informed consent. It's all about shared decision-making. It's all about tailoring your treatments to you. I know people who have had deep success on pure herbal protocols, the Buhner protocol. I never did herbals myself, but I know people who have, and I know people who have gone into remission, or even some say that they have been cured by it. This is not hoity-toity, you know, quackery stuff, right? We know for a fact that there is science that is proving different herbal and organic type things can eradicate Borrelia burgdorferi in the test tube. That is not the same as eradicating it in a human body. We haven't gotten to those trials yet. But if you look up the work of Dr. Ying Zhang, who used to be working at Johns Hopkins, I think you'll find a lot of scientific evidence to support this herbal type idea. Lots more science and research needs to be done to kind of confirm that. But for me, I did 3 months, of IV ceftriaxone through a PICC line. I spent about another 12 months on different oral antibiotics and antiparasitics. Don't forget that Babesia. I had a fever every day of 100 to 101 for 4 years. And they kept telling me it was endocrine, but none of those tests came back positive for anything. And then it was considered psychosomatic. I don't know who gives themselves a fever every day between 100 and 101 or how that would even be possible, but okay. Idiopathic. We don't know why. Well, it was the Babesia. I had to treat Babesia 3 times in order for my slides and smears to be clear. So you probably want to know, what'd you test positive for? I'm happy to talk about this because it's in my discharge paperwork from my 18-month-long medical retirement board. Borrelia burgdorferi, tick-borne relapsing fever, anaplasma, Bartonella henslii, and Babesia microti. And that was a test through several different labs. I was diagnosed and treated at a mainstream medical facility, and that was about 5 years ago. So that's a long answer to Kenny's short question. The most important thing, Kenny, is to find a doctor who is knowledgeable on this and willing to be your partner in your recovery, willing to walk with you, right, with informed consent all along the way. So I, of course, am making an assumption that, Kenny, that you're the one that's ill, but you may very well be the caregiver or loved one of someone who is. So doing your own research, look, the stuff that, you know, is kind of out there in medical textbooks, I think we know is old. All of this new evolving evidence, the science, it's out there. Go to reputable sites, PubMed, NIH. This peer-reviewed literature sits there. Why I know more and have read more of that than my PCP still astounds me. But you yourself, Kenny, can educate yourself and print out that NIH and PubMed literature, walk it to the doctor. And if they're not willing to read it and have a conversation with you about it, like a professional adult, go find another doctor.
Right. Thank you. We have another question from Claire. She said, thank you so much, Nicole, for your amazing talk. When you were medically retired from the Air Force, were you able to qualify for disability with tick-borne illness as a diagnosis?
Oh, Claire. Oh man, you're getting right to my heart here. First of all, I love the name Claire. I've always loved that name. So there you go. Claire. So this is a difficult thing, right? I was medically retired for chronic systemic tick-borne illness. I always keep this printed. Here's my whole medical review. More than 20 doctors over an 18-month period reviewed everything and validated my diagnosis. So you get medically retired from active duty, and you immediately are supposed to have this amazing, seamless transition to the Department of Veterans Affairs. No, it's a horrific transition if you are somebody with tick-borne illness. At that time, 5 years ago, actually, I guess it would be 4.5 years ago, there weren't any codes for VA disability for chronic systemic tick-borne illness. There was only a code for acute Lyme disease, and they would only give you disability pay for the length of time, right, that you were acute, which meant 21 days of doxycycline, because the myth is that we're all cured at any stage of disease with 21 days of doxycycline. You and I know that that's not true. Science even shows that that's not true, but we haven't yet changed the system, the bureaucracy, the process. And so at that point, they said, well, you have to file individually for each and every symptom you have. Now, right? You know what I'm talking about. 8 systems in my body. At my worst, my symptoms were 63. I wrote them all down, from jaw pain to foot pain to malaise to executive cognitive dysfunction, 63. The VA says you can't do that. I said, well, you're not allowing me, right, to go with chronic systemic tick-borne illness because I'm not acute, because I'm not actively treating, because according to you, VA, I'm cured. So I'm proud to say that I have been a gigantic pain in the butt. And just 2 years ago, they did change the CFR codes. And now you can be listed as having chronic Lyme disease. It is an actual statement. You can see it. It's called residuals of infection. And there is a code for that. So it's very real. I'm proud to have been part of a team that worked to make that happen. So do I get VA disability pay for some of my lingering symptoms? Yes, I do. And I'm glad for them because I still pay for a nutritionist and a health coach, and I still get some medical acupuncture and massage, and that money helps me maintain a quality of life worth living. The VA has a very long way to go on acknowledging things like tick-borne relapsing fever, Babesia, Bartonella. I am working on that. And we'll do it one code at a time, because that's how bureaucracy and giant administrative processes are. But if anyone wants to join forces with me to get the DOD and the VA to keep moving in the right direction, I welcome your help.
Okay, I don't see any other questions right now. So thank you, Nicole, so much for speaking with us today and sharing your story.
Well, thank you very much for having me. Again, for those of you who are tuning in or are going to watch this later through the link, I believe you. I support you. And you have an entire community here to lean on. So loosen your grip, yield to overcome, and reach out to us. And we will try our best to get you back to a quality of life that you can be proud of.
Thank you so much, Nicole. It's always a pleasure, and you're so appreciated. Yeah.
Joy to spend time with you.
Awesome. So with that, I guess we'll wrap up for the weekend. Welcome, just so happy everybody could join us today. And if you have any other questions, please reach out to us. I know there's one more screenshot for how to reach us. So you can find us on our webpage, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, for both COTBDAA, as well as the tick-borne Colorado Lyme and Tick-Borne Disease Support Group. So thank you, everybody, and have a really great day.
Thank you.